Hello there my friends, the editor here, and I decided to make a quick video explaining my thoughts and opinions on the My Little Pony movie that recently came out in cinemas in the UK. Now, normally I wouldn't make one of these quick summary videos, and given a significant amount of time, I might make a full-fledged review, but for now, I'll keep it simple. Now, this is going to be the only warning to any of you watching this. Spoiler alert on the highest level. If you don't want to hear anything about the movie. Having said that, I will try to keep as many secrets as I can about the movie, so not to take away the feel for yourself. Now, before I go into anything, let's just go into what MLP has under its track record for when it comes to movies. The Equestria Girl movies, to be blunter, and the hate and disgust they have all received in their own respectable ways. Having said that, there are times in the movies where they really made you feel sorry for certain characters, grow a strong bond to them, and feel the hassle and conflict going through their minds. I'm talking mainly about Sunset Shimmer when I say that. They really need to bring her back into the show for, say, a two-parter or something. Anyway, on purely my own skepticism about the movies, 4 out of 10, 8 out of 10, 5 out of 10, buck off. So yeah, not a high expectation for the actual pony movie. But I went along with it, and because I love you guys, and I love this fandom. But having said that, from watching it, I'm gonna say it's halfway between second Equestria Girls and third, leaning more towards second. Though I enjoyed it, I'm not gonna lie, there were times where the story was meh. The animation was really overdone or lacking in areas. I fell in love with the characters, save for a few, and the new art style really set itself away from any of the other previous MLP movies. Faster paced, smoother, more 3D, brighter, and more colours on the rainbow than Lightning Bliss's butt in places, and in other places, it adds a steampunk thing to it almost. But with it being MLP, they can always return to the basic stereotypes as we can be expected, such as starting things off with another festival. Because what MLP related content would it be without parties? Cramming all the cameos from past characters we've known from the show, which again makes no sense because if you don't watch the show and only just came for the movie, you won't understand any of the character placement references. And even characters we've grown to see more and more are only there for background characters and don't even get any lines to say, alongside not including characters from the show, but for a stupid reason, including them in the end credits scene. People who have watched the movie, you know what I mean when I say that. And not forgetting the ever popular trope of introducing more characters to follow up of instead of bringing back old characters we want to see come back in the animation style and story. There are hiccups like that everywhere in the movie, but to its credit, the characters they introduce are very entertaining and I fell in love with them all, except for one, but we'll get to them in a moment. Story-wise, it's basic. Evil comes to rule Equestria.
Of course!
And it's up to the six to save the day while on the run from the villains hunting them down to put a stop to whatever they're trying to do. And meeting up with the new characters they come to grow strong bonds to. And this is the first time for me, but I wanted to know more about the main antagonist in the movie, Commander Tempest. Now her design, granted, puts her as edgy with a dark past, blah blah blah. However, personally, I just keep laughing all the time I see her because her OC just looks like a Rule 63 of my mate Zane's OC Base Hunter. Having said that though, this is a great villain. Her devious voice, her not so edgy backstory, but more of a sympathetic deal to get her old life back. And they even managed to get some funny moments out of her. Also, she's a freaking badass. Threatening, intimidating, and all at the same time not letting her emotions get in the way of because she has a job to do, even if that means betraying her own kind. Voiced by Emily Blunt, she is the best villain I have ever seen performance-wise, which is more than I can say for who she works for. The Storm King, voiced by Lee Schreiber. That's right, Sabretooth from X-Men. And wow, you suck more than Sombra. Compared to Tempest, he's just a baby that's thrown his bottle out of the pram and expects to have everything go his way. He doesn't even become a threat until the end of the movie. In fact, we see him at the beginning of the movie and that's it. We don't see him again until the last 30 minutes and only then does he become a major concern. Design-wise, he and his henchmen are just abominable snowmen or yeti, whatever or either. I don't care. He's boring, his motivation's boring, his performance is boring, and he sucks at what he does. Other than that, he's a whiny bitch. However, best character? You should have seen this coming. Kappa the Cat. Now, I first remember seeing this guy in leaked pictures online, and holy crap, the designer can only basically put him as he's the sly Hamilton cat who just happens to be the freaky inbred child of Keechee FIM and Eric the Cat. But he is so enjoyable. He's sly, he's silver-tongued, he's a slight con artist, and when he gets befriended, he's torn from what he's originally set out to do in the story to becoming a great aid to the six. Best character in the movie. Well, either him or the pirate parrots. Congratulations, Elicity, even you get cameos in this movie as well. Now, they don't do too much in the beginning, again until the end of the movie per se, but it's very interesting to see the different designs they come up with, mostly because we're not in Equestria. Now, most of our adventures have been mostly around the north, west, and east, but this time, we're heading south. Past the Badlands of the Dragons to uncharted territories. Which is great to see because it makes sense for why there's no recognisable characters so far down south. But I can't speak too much or else tell you the rest of the story. However, I will say this, the six perform as well as you expect them to do. They all match their personalities and play off one another, each matching with the new characters they meet along the way. The focus is thankfully on them and rarely cuts away to a different set of characters for mostly a few minutes. And yes, as expected, the central focus is Twilight and this being a friendship and thing and all, but overall, I think it was nice. I mean, I did at one point feel like I was watching a Lord of the Rings film where they rushed the story in one area to get to another area and so on, but still, I enjoyed it. Would I recommend watching it? Yeah, I would. Would I watch it again? Maybe not. Once you've watched it for yourself, you can make your own call whether or not it's for you. But this was just my opinion, and I'd love to hear what you have to say. Your own opinions are as valid as mine after all. But again, if you do have any comments about it, try and keep as many spoilers as you can to a minimum, please. Not everyone's watched it yet. But until then, my friends, I'm the editor, and cut, that's a wrap.